Hey folks, welcome to another Triple T Thursday. For those just joining us, that's Tools, Tips, and Talk, where we'll discuss info for the knife maker. Today's episode, we continue our beginner series on building this knife. Today we're going to do the initial bevels, and we're going to talk about all things heat treat. Let's get into it.
Okay folks, ready to get back at it on this blade. So what we need to do this week is to put the bevel in, and then we're going to do all the heat treating. So before we do the bevel, we need to talk about scribe lines. And I've said this in many videos, but I'm going to repeat it here. If you don't put scribe lines before you start grinding, you have no idea what you're grinding to. So, very important. For this, we're going to use this blue Dycom layout fluid. You can use a magic marker. It's just that when you dip it, the magic marker tends to wash off. This will not. So it's worth the price. Okay, so we're going to coat the blade on both sides, and you'll see what I'm going to do. So we've coated the blade in blue Dycom. Now, the first thing we're going to do is put the scribe line to know where we're going to scribe the bevel to. And for this, I have this little guide here, which is just a little carbide tip, and you can adjust the height and like this. If you don't have one of these, don't worry about it. Grab like an 1/8 inch drill bit. Let's use a 1/16. You want something that's roughly the size of your blade, and then we're going to scribe it on both sides, so that'll give us two parallel lines. Now you do need something flat. I have a granite surface plate, but if you don't want to spend the money on one of these, which I don't advise you do if you're starting out, go get yourself a tile from Home Depot, Lowe's, whatever your big box store is. I think I paid $4 for that tile. It's pretty much just as flat as this. So I'm just going to press this down, and with the drill bit, scribe a line. And I'll scribe one on the other side. Because the tip of the drill bit will always be in the center. There we go. We have two lines that are kind of messy, but you know, you get the point. For the actual where the bevel is, we're going to use calipers. And really, you need to get a set of calipers. And remember, and if you haven't watched my grinding basics, go watch that. I'll put a link up here. But your bevel is always going to go up further than you intend. So put your mark of where you want the bevel about 1/4 inch lower. So I'm just going to do this, and I'm trying to follow the curve of the blade about there, and the same on the other side. Whoops. It's hard to do this upside down. Over here, so we're going to make this simple, and we're going to make this plunge line pretty much straight. And we're going to mark off where we want it. So it's going to be about here, and then we're going to soften the top, and it'll be about there. So now I'm going to mark this right here, so we know where it is, and do the same thing on the other side. Okay, so that's what we're going to grind to. We've got our center lines. I might redo this one again because I see I scraped off a bunch of the blue here, but you get the point. All right, so I redid the scribe line. It's a lot neater now and a lot darker and easier to see. Now we're going to start the grinding. I've got a brand new 36 grit belt here. This is one of the Broadbeck incinerators, which of course I recommend. And we're going to start by just putting that initial bevel in at about a 30-degree angle. So let's get that done.
I normally recommend not starting with a fresh belt on this step because it kind of takes off all of the abrasives, but I just forgot. If you haven't watched my grinding basics video, definitely go watch that. I talk about posture, approaching the belt, all kind of things that are really important here. When grinding, you're typically going to be better with your strong hand. So I'm right-handed, so this side is usually better. When I switch to my left side, that's when it gets a little wonky, but with practice, you'll get them the same. What I'm doing here is rocking the knife back and forth and just checking for symmetry on both sides. Symmetry is what you're looking for. Right here I do a little oops. Sometimes when you're grinding a knife and you thin it out, it'll get wedged between the rest and the grinder. So here I'm repositioning my rest to have it a little closer.
So there it is after initial grind. You can see it's not perfect, but again, this is only initial grind. It doesn't need to be perfect. What's important is this and this are the same. Okay, so where that bevel comes up to, because if this is too low or too high on one side, then your blade's going to have, basically it's got more metal on one side and it's going to have a tendency to warp. So we're trying to prevent that. We also want to make sure that right here is the same. Okay, and it looks pretty even. It's certainly good enough for heat treat. We're going to put a sharpening notch into it before we go to heat treat, but then we'll talk about the heat treat process. This step is completely optional, but what this does, especially for new knife makers, is it can hide your oops. And here's what I mean. You're going to be putting a notch right at the plunge line. So not only is it now easy to sharpen because you don't have this little wider area to sharpen, but if your plunge isn't perfect, this will kind of hide it a little bit. So what I usually do is just put my fingers here. I'm using a chainsaw file. I think this is like a 3/16 chainsaw file. And I'm going to put it, basically I want it centered or a little bit ahead of the plunge line. So let's put it right there. Okay, so here's our sharpening choil. Some people call this a Spanish notch, but I just call it a sharpening choil. And you can see that I've kind of taken a little bit of the plunge line off here, and there we go. All right, it's time to talk about heat treating. But folks, if you haven't watched my video on heat treating, go watch that first. I'm going to put a link up there, pause this video, go watch that one and come back, because I'm going to use some terms and some descriptions that you're just going to get in that video. So go watch that one and then we'll come back and we're going to apply those techniques onto using a forge for all of our heat treating. Okay, you're back. Let's talk about the heat treating step. So the first thing we're going to do is normalize this blade. We did a bunch of forging on this, we've done grinding, we've done a whole bunch of things that have messed with the internal structure of this steel. So we want to get it all nice and back to a kind of a normalized state. So we're going to put this past its critical temperature, okay, and this is 5160, so its critical temperature is around 1525. So we're going to put this past that, we'll probably put it around 1600 degrees or we're going to shoot for that. So we know that this steel will lose its magnetic property around 1475. So that's mostly what we're going to use. There were some other techniques like using salt or something like that, but most people are going to have a magnet. We're going to go with that. So I'm going to be heating this to about non-magnetic, and I'm going to keep testing it, the whole blade, and I'm just going to watch the color. Okay, when I do this, I'm actually going to turn the lights out, so you're going to see it a lot easier on what the temperature is going to be. So once it loses its magnetism, we're going to go about 2 or 3 minutes or kind of a shade brighter. And then after that, we're going to let it cool. And I'm going to show you a really cool effect when this thing cools down.
The first thing you're going to notice is I'm putting the blade in tang first. The tang is always going to be thicker, or most cases, it's going to be thicker. You want that to heat up first. Then you're going to flip it around and start doing the tip. If you don't, you're going to burn the tip of your knife. In this step, I'm putting the knife and leaning it against the wall of the forge. It's going to take a minute or two for it to heat up. After that, I'm going to keep the knife in the tongs the entire time. The knife is still magnetic at this point, but that's fine. At least the tang is heated up enough, I can flip it around and start to heat the blade. This is where you need to be super careful. You'll notice I'm holding the knife edge down. I want to keep the thinnest part of the blade away from the flame so that it heats up evenly. Don't burn the tip. I said in the heat treating video, it's a good idea to put a piece of tube steel in your forge and then put your knife in that. I just didn't have one at the time, so you'll notice I'm putting it in and out of the forge and moving it around just to get a nice even heat. What I'm doing here is holding the knife deep into the forge so the tip is on the other side of the burner so I can heat the blade and not overheat the tip. Remember, the tip is the thinnest part of steel, so it's definitely going to heat up quicker. So I keep doing this for several minutes, getting it hot, warming it up slowly past the magnetic temperature, and then finally I think it's ready. Now this part I think is really cool. If you watch the blade cool down, you'll see a shadow move across the blade. That's the molecular process of the steel kind of resetting itself. But some people say that's the spirit of the blade moving through it, but I don't know about that.
So I've just taken a piece of coat hanger and I'm hanging the blade just down there underneath the forge so that no one will touch it, it won't hit anything, and it's gonna cool in still air.
So here we are, back at it, repeating the process again, but this time we're gonna go about just up to non-magnetic and a little bit higher, but we want to be below the critical temperature. And then we're going to do 2 cycles of this, cooling between each one. These cycles are really for grain refinement. This is where we want to shrink those crystals in the steel to be small, so therefore our steel is not brittle. So I've decided to do the remainder with the lights on so you guys could see more what I'm doing. I've got my quench tanks here, and for this steel, 5160, we're going to be using the front tank, which is Park's AAA. I've had a piece of mild steel sitting in the forge, and now I'm just heating up the oil. I want it around 120 degrees. This actually ended up heating up quite a bit higher, but that's fine. By the time my knife comes in the oil, it'll have cooled down. Now it's time to start the final process of doing the heating before the quench. Same method here, but we're going to heat to past magnetic and are right around the 1500 degree mark. And this just takes practice to know what that temperature is and looks like. '5160 is actually one of those steels that you can actually use canola oil successfully. Don't do that with 1080, 1084, 1095 steels. So I'm testing the blade, we're past non-magnetic. Now it's just getting a nice even heat on the blade. And sorry about the camera, guys. I really need to fix the camera and make sure it's not doing this weird autofocus. This wasn't the best example of quenching. I kind of hit the edge of the tank, but you want to go in fast. That will actually prevent you from getting the flame up, but because the knife kind of stopped halfway, then it flamed up. But I just blow out the flames and keep going. You want to make sure you agitate the blade up and down, not side to side, but up and down, And that will take kind of a vapor barrier away from the blade. And that will keep it from warping, and it will make sure it hardens. You got to make sure you leave the blade in the oil for at least 10 seconds, usually longer.
Okay, so it looks really, really, no warps, nothing. It looks really good. Let's check for hardness. So I'm going to grab a 60 HRC file. Okay, that's not good. We'll give it a little bit, because it may not be fully hardened yet, so we're going to give it a little while. It's still pretty hot. And that's what you see people in Forged in Fire do, is they'll take it out of the oil, they'll test it right away, and they'll say, oh, it's not hard yet, and they try to requench it. We're going to give it a little bit. It already sounds better. All right, so what I'm gonna do now is I'm actually just gonna grind this a little bit with a 120 belt right about here, and we're gonna test it on the HRC tester just to show you how close we got. Let's see how we did. And now we'll see what it is. We should get this around 63, something like that. Look at that. 64. Let's try it again. And that one came out around 62 and a half. So we'll do one more for good measure. Yeah, we're rated 64 there, so that second measurement was a bit of an anomaly. All right, so now we're going to temper it in the oven. This one, since it's at about 64, we're going to temper this at about 375 for two cycles of 2 hours. So I'll be using my kiln for this, but don't worry, guys. You can do this in your kitchen oven exactly the same. I'm doing it this way just so that I can turn this and go to bed.
Thanks for joining me on this episode. We got this all heat treated, tempered. I actually ran the HRC tester on this after the temper, and it's right above 59. So about 59 and a half HRC, which is perfect. So we did a good job on heat treating it. So now, next episode, we'll do the final grinding, and we'll move on in the process. Thanks for joining me, folks. We'll see you on the next one.